What the hell? Brandon, what? Stop. What the hell are you doing?
Nathan, I'm getting super excited for this week's episode because, I mean, we already talked about the crappy Mortal Kombat, but now we're doing the 90s one. Yeah.
No, we're not talking about the 90s Mortal Kombat. It's that other fighting game from the 90s that they made a movie of.
No, we already did Street Fighter.
No, it's not Street Fighter.
Oh.
It's the other fighting movie from the 90s that they made a movie
of. Double Dragon. Okay.
No, it's not. That's a side-scrolling beat-em-up. No, not that one.
Oh, so Streets of Rage.
No, that's Streets of Rage. Come on, man. It's the fighting movie that came out in the 90s. It's not Street Fighter. It's not Mortal Kombat.
It's about time we do a period piece. All right, Golden Axe. Let's do this.
No, it's not. They didn't make a movie out of Golden Axe. Okay, it's Tekken. We're watching the movie Tekken. You know, with the guys and the one's a knight, and then there's a little dinosaur, and the dude's got weird hair.
Super Mario Brothers.
Oh God damn it! You know when I pick a movie. That's when I'm under pressure now. The question always comes back to me, what were they thinking now?
Welcome, everyone. Welcome once again to another episode of What Were They Thinking? This podcast, you're asking, what do they do? Well, we talk about bad to questionable movies. Both of us do. And sometimes we have a guest. Will that be the case this week? We're about to find out. But before we get into any other details, I am Brendan. And joining me is the Steve to my gin. Nathan, introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Steve. 7 foot tall girl who wants to rent King Kong Lives.
Oh, callback. Explosion noise.
Hi, everybody.
So, Nathan, we're here to talk about a fighting movie from the 90s that's not Mortal Kombat.
Well, the game is from the 90s. The movie isn't.
Right. The game is from the 90s. The movie's from 2009 or 2010 or 2011, depending on where you look it up.
Right.
So it's really a mystery. This movie came out in all 3 years. They did like a triple Morbius release thing where they were like, oh,
everybody was busy that weekend. So they re-released it later
and everyone was still busy. And then the third time everyone was even busier.
So dump it onto VOD now.
but of course we are not alone. We are not alone here, on this planet or on this podcast. Joining us in the booth, ladies and gentlemen, returning to the podcast, Mr. Striking Distance himself from the home video hustle, Brent.
What?
I like how you gave him the Tony the Tiger entrance. I know. He's Brent.
That's right. He's part of your balanced breakfast, everyone.
These flakes ain't frosted over here, baby. What does that mean? I don't fucking know.
Because it's not the late 90s and you're not into NSYNC.
There you go. I'm not Michael Cole out here in these streets. Wrestling already.
There it is. Secured.
Now, we should note, you're it's not the late 90s, but Brent is into NSYNC. That's what I just want to clarify that.
You know, funny enough, I got my little emulation box upstairs, and I'm just getting all kind of games legally offline. And there's an NSYNC video game, Brendan, and I have it now.
And it's great, right?
It's a game.
Moreover, do you have the Marky Mark and Crisscross make your own video game for the Sega CD?
Oh, not only do I have those, I have the CNC Music Factory and the NXS ones.
Wow.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this.
What's up?
Let me ask you this in the NSYNC video game. Is there a level where you almost have a cameo in Attack of the Clones?
No, but there should be. They should have been Attack of the Clowns. Put that shit. I mean, that movie.
Attack of the Clowns.
Hey, from Clown Shakes. That movie sucked. I'll say it now.
Hot take.
And you know, the funny thing about it is that I know there's always this beef about episode one and episode two. I actually think I dislike episode two more.
I think I do too, actually.
Okay, so it ain't just me. Okay, I thought I was crazy.
I thought episode one was not good, but it's episode two is a lot more boring.
It's boring as fuck. Okay, yeah. I'm glad it's not just me.
All right, Nathan, tiebreaker, which one?
Oh.
I have a raging indifference towards
actually,
both of them.
I don't know why I said there would be that was a tiebreaker. We both agreed.
Yeah.
Math is not my strong suit. But you know what is my strong suit?
Not calendars.
Not calendars. Thank you for adding to my list of weaknesses. No, but talking about bad to questionable movies, and that's what we're doing. We're talking about 2009's, or 10, or 11's, Tekken. The movie. A movie that I did not know existed until about 2 weeks ago. Or until about whenever Brent suggested it. And I said, Brent, we're not going to play a video game on the podcast.
You could.
Yeah.
Now, it's funny because this ain't even the first Tekken movie. There's an animated one that came out before this because over on the Home Video Hustle podcast, we've watched this and the animated movie. And there's actually two more after this, Brennan. So there's four Tekken movies out there.
You know, we gave Steve praise for not shit plugging right away, and look what ends up next.
Right away.
Look, if y'all listen to the Home Video Hustle podcast, in the last episode that came out was Hard Rock Zombies, and Brendan commits to shit plugging immediately in that episode as well.
I don't recall.
You shit plugged your show. You shit plugged for Screening Country. You shit plugged Montrose in probably like the first 10 minutes.
Aw, thanks.
See,
goddamn right. Hustle.
See? That's what I
Tekken. Do. Tekken, folks.
Tekken.
What is the plot of Tekken? Well,
plot.
There's a guy named Jin, and he's kind of a guy going around and he's kind of stealing shit for the resistance, I guess. Because there's this big thing that happened called the Terror Wars, which is the worst name of a fake war in a movie ever.
That's a bootleg Star Wars movie from the 90s.
Star Crash.
Yeah.
So governments fell, corporations took over, and what remained is collectively known as Iron Fist. I think, I don't know. But America fell to Tekken. There's That's all right. kinds of other companies. There's like 8 corporations that control the world.
G-Corp.
Which is like not far from reality. and right away, I was confused. Okay, I was confused right off the bat, guys, because right away they say there's a yearly tournament. It's kill or be killed. And then later they reveal that now this tournament has changed and it's kill or be killed as a twist. And I thought, I thought this was the thing from the very beginning.
Yeah, he said, every fight now is battle to the death.
Right, which
so I guess before you could just call it off.
I guess so.
It was optional. Confused. It's like with Mortal Kombat. You can kill them, but you don't have to.
You don't have to do a fatality.
Yeah.
Because I was confused for a long time as to why they were fighting not to the death for so long. And then all of a sudden they were like, we fight to the death now. And I'm like, yeah, okay. I thought that was what we were doing here.
Because like anyway. TNT, we need drama, Brendan.
But basically the plot again, like I said, there's a yearly tournament. Jin wants to get involved. His mom doesn't want him to, but luckily she dies.
Gets blown
the fuck up. And he does end up getting involved to get revenge on, Mishima, played by Cary Tagawa. And
who was the big bad in Mortal Kombat?
There
Shang
you go.
Tsung.
That's where I recognized him from.
Yep. Shang Tsung.
And he enters the tournament, and a lot of fighting happens, and hilarity ensues. And that's it. That's the show, folks.
Bye.
What were they thinking? Thanks for joining.
So, guys, this movie...
That's pretty good.
This movie starts off with a lot of exposition,
yeah.
So much so that I was rewinding a few times to be like, wait, what? Okay, hold on. Let me just figure this out. Okay, Terror Wars, governments, corporations, Tekken, tournament. Got it. Like everything else just escaped my brain.
You know why, right?
Tell me.
Because this movie's plot has absolutely nothing to do with the video games. I don't know what the hell they're talking about.
I am shocked.
Like none of this shit. There's no Tekken City.
No.
That fucked me up when they said that. It's like, it looked like the Running Man. It's like a fighting version of the Running Man. That's what I thought the whole movie.
It's funny you say that. My issue with it was that I always known the game as Tekken.
Mm-hmm.
And then right out of the gate, we get the movie is named Tekken. And there's a corporation named Tekken. And there's a city named Tekken. And I was like, oh, all right, we get it. We know what movie we're watching, okay?
You
Although,
you were...
to be fair,
to be fair,
Shang Tsung, I think, says Mortal Kombat, as well as Christopher Lambert. They say Mortal Kombat about a gajillion times during Mortal Kombat, the movie.
So were you expecting like the main character to pop up and be like, I'm Jin Tekken?
Yes. Tekken. I would have loved it.
Wait for the twist.
Well, right away, we're seeing some fighting, and then we go to 5 days earlier, and I'm already like, I don't like this slow motion fighting bullshit. This better not be the whole movie. And
no, it's just so they could get the fan service in right away so you can see the costume.
Like, yeah, don't leave.
You're going to see the stuff you came to see. We got the costumes right. It's okay, guys.
To be fair to this movie.
To be fair.
As opposed to the new Mortal Kombat, at least this movie about a tournament shows the tournament.
Yeah. That's fair true. Statement.
Yeah. Just saying. But we get we see the character Jin. He's running from some soldiers who are shooting at him. There's a lot of, I don't know, garbage fires and stuff. It's very post-apocalyptic looking. They play that fucking song. It's like, you're going down. What's that? You know what I mean? That song that was in like every
that's
early
a real
to
song?
Mid-2000s movie.
I don't know what song. I don't know that song.
I wrote down it's the You're Going Down song, but I can't think of the way it
goes. I thought
it was
just movie butt rock. I thought is all it was. I didn't even pay much attention.
I've heard it in a bunch of movies like right around that time period, and I'm just like, oh god. And immediately we're starting this weird thing where he nails one of the guards and goes,
whoa,
like, you know,
I don't remember that.
That's
it's a spicy cut.
Yeah.
He hits one of the guards.
Hey, I don't remember that.
And he says that's gotta hurt. And I'm like, is he gonna be a quippy son of a bitch? Like, really, on top of all this? And he's not. He literally just does that then and that's it. I thought it was weird. And he also says it in like the laziest quip way possible. Like, that's gotta hurt.
That's gotta hurt.
Moving on, guys.
No time.
Jin is running away from them. He's doing a lot of cool parkour.
All over Sector 7G.
Hey!
Hey, shit.
Really wasn't called Sector 7G, but it was. That's way shorter than what they named the goddamn thing.
Oh,
it's like Sector 14-75Z. I'm like, that's not how you do stuff like that. Just give it something real quick. And luckily, someone got a production note because they just started calling it the Anvil afterwards.
There you go.
So were you expecting like Ares to be like planting flowers in the background somewhere? Is that her name in that game?
Oh, you're talking about Final Fantasy. When I said Sector 7G, I was talking about the Homer Simpsons.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought 7G was... Okay, my bad.
Jin
is overload.
Wow, you calling someone a nerd, Brent? Okay.
Yeah.
Jin is running away.
Just looking at the posters on the back wall. There,
that's some fly shit, ain't it? Dolomite and Superfly.
That's some obscure nerdy cinema stuff too, buddy. I'm just gonna put that out there.
Jin is hiding while all these soldiers are just executing bitches left and right. And he goes back to the. Not female dogs, just killing a bunch of people.
I'm sorry.
And Jin goes back to this like hideout thing, and he's like, here, I got your shit that you wanted. And they have a discussion about like music, and he's like, and this is real music, not that corporate shit you listen to.
Oh my god.
Yeah,
he's like the Beatles. And I'm like, what? Like, you went to the most popular band you could think of to think of like, this is like the real like indie shit.
Yeah.
Actually, I didn't even really catch anything after when he started talking about the music you listen to today is crap. I'm like, oh, it's good to see that opinionated dads who were into music in like during their teens are still around in the future.
Damn.
Everything when I was a kid is better than now forever.
Trump,
always.
Where'd Trump come from?
Well, we can take the blame for that, but he was an 80s thing.
Remember when he was. Remember when he was funny?
No.
I remember when he was funny to laugh at. And then it got serious and scary.
Shit got real.
So he drops off this stuff for the resistance. The guy is like, here's your money. And he's like, pay me in global bucks. That never comes up again.
Need some bison dollars. Oh, well, sorry.
No, I think it does come up one more time.
Does it?
Once.
Yeah, one more time before we actually get into the... You know, the real meat of the story.
I saw your once delivery there, fucking Joe Piscopo.
Once. Johnny Dangerously, go watch it.
There, that's a fantastic flick.
There's a Derek, did y'all catch what he said about the little device that he gave him? I laughed my ass off when I heard it. I guess showing my nerdiness now.
Oh, it's a new version of the internet.
That, but or something he also like said that. It's like 20,000 gigabytes.
So oh, shit.
It's like somebody just like, oh, let's make it sound like it's cool. It's like, oh, it's 20,000 gigabytes. Like, who the, no, shut up. That bursts out
so it's 2 terabytes.
That's right.
We see Mishima come on this big screen, and he's talking about how the Iron Fist tournament is going to happen in Tekken. And the extras in this movie are mostly excited, but some of them look like they don't know how to, they should be reacting.
They were shocked by his fucking hair.
I think the person, I mean, it was.
Patty had so many notes about his hair.
Mishima's hair? Yeah. Well, yeah. It's got like, what? It's like gray on the side and like pokes out.
It's like the video game.
That's how it looks in the game, right? Yeah, exactly.
But when you put that in real life, it looks very odd.
Dumb.
Right.
like, listen, you don't have to, you don't change everything, but don't be afraid to make a few changes.
There was a character in one of the Tekken games that had like, fucking kid and play hair, but he was like
Paul Phoenix.
He was like a jacked white dude, and I was like, man, I hope that guy shows up. I really want to see some white guy with kid and play hair.
Nope.
But didn't happen.
Nope.
Big yellow hair too.
yeah, it was like super blonde.
So we get the announcement that the Iron Fist tournament is happening in Tekken. Jin, meanwhile, is at this club, and he goes up to some guy who looks like a drug dealer. It turns out he just buys some coffee and an orange from him.
Yeah.
$100 an ounce for coffee.
Well, it's a rough economy, man.
It's none of that stepped on freeze-dried bullshit. This is from real, like, coffee beans right off the plantation.
Colombian.
I don't understand why. They don't make it clear or say that, you know, the world is like polluted. Like we're not in a Highlander 2 situation here.
Damn.
No, they don't. They don't really. They just kind of. We just kind of get this scene. And again, so many things are set up in these opening scenes, and then not really anything is done with them.
And this is the other place where the Global Bucks thing comes up because he's like, he gives Jin a price, but then Jin flashes like. The Global Bucks, and it's a lower amount, but he's like, oh yeah, I'll take those.
But again, so, like, that's it.
That's it.
Like,
yeah.
There's no purpose for
any
of this.
See, Brennan, we got to get to the tournament. You wanted the damn tournament, so we get, fuck all this. We got to get to the fights.
We're getting there. But first, 2 toughs. By the way, the guy he buys coffee and an orange from, I think, stole Lenny Kravitz's wardrobe.
Oh, yeah.
he runs into 2 toughs that get in his face, and they're like, well, you're so passive about this whole oppressive government thing. Like, why don't you fight, Jin? Why don't you fight someone? Why don't you make a stand? And I was like, okay, well, I don't know what this is all about. We get some opening ceremonies, and we meet Mishima and his son, who looked to me looked and sounded to me like a discount Josh Brolin. I was calling him Josh Folin the whole time.
Hey.
I see what
you mean. Really,
F-A-U-X, people.
Yep, exactly. He really did. Like he looked a little bit like him, but he sounded so much like him. Like I looked away from the screen. And I was like, holy fuck, it sounds like Thanos is still on the screen right now. But basically we learned that Josh Folin is Mishima's son. And he's a little bit of a loose cannon. He clearly wants to take over Tekken, and Mishima is like, you are not ready for Tekken, sir. And tells him to just keep an eye out for insurgents and anti-corporate people. We don't want a bunch of protesters and shit.
Yeah, you're head of security.
Yeah.
That's important.
You're head of security. The security team is under your control. That will come up later, unlike most of the things in this movie.
Yeah. Hey, so they got one.
They got one. Well, they're about to get two. Because Jin goes home to his mom with the orange and the coffee, and she doesn't say stop running drugs, but it's essentially stop running drugs. His mom is also like, I will not have you get involved in Tekken. I don't want you to be in the tournament. Don't go into the tournament. It's a bad idea. Fighting is bad. Meanwhile, we see that she's the one who trained him, which I thought was weird.
Uh-huh. His mom is a character in the video game.
Well, it's not that she doesn't want him fighting. She doesn't want him to have anything to do with Tekken.
That's not, well, yeah, yeah.
For reasons.
So if they move to, I don't know, what was one of the other corporations?
G Corp.
Okay, so if they move to like the country wherever G Corp is kind of over, she would probably not have a problem with him fighting because he'd be fighting for G Corp, not Tekken.
There you go.
Right.
It fucked me up when I heard G Corp because I was thinking of the wrong thing. I thought it's like that Godzilla, but that's G Force. So I did backwards.
Yes.
Like a G Corp. Like a G Corp.
Explosion.
Bars. So yeah, we learn right away that, you know, she doesn't want him getting involved. And but that's okay, because then he goes and hooks up with his girlfriend. Keep that in mind, guys. He has a girlfriend.
It's fine. Yeah. Fine. She got blown up.
No, she didn't.
No, she did. She's at the end. No, she's at the very end of the movie.
No, she got blown up. She got blown up. That's what I was.
No, hate to tell you. But he has a girlfriend in this scene, they have the cringiest dialogue exchange because
what
she says. I know,
no.
Brent, I'm gonna blow your mind right now. The dialogue in this movie, not great.
What?
But she says, she says to him, based on all the runs he goes on and everything for people and all the dangerous errands he runs, she says, no one understands how you're not dead. And he says, I guess I'm lucky. And then what does she say, Brent?
You're about to get lucky.
Ooh, Shakespeare.
That's right.
Eat shit.
Every man got dick bulge immediately in the theater watching this movie.
Theater? This thing made it to theaters.
Oh, there are numbers. Brendan didn't say.
I thought this was a Fifth Thursday thing.
Oh, can I tell you the numbers, Brendan?
If you want to tell us now, yeah, go ahead.
Y'all want to hear these numbers. Can y'all, you know what? Can I indulge a little home video hustling this one to the podcast? Can y'all guess how much this cost to make?
Fuck, it's time for the clock game.
Yeah. So like
25 million.
25, what you think, Nathan?
Or how much it cost to make or how much it made?
How much it cost to make.
How much it cost to make? $15 million.
$30 million. Brennan was closer.
$30 million for this thing.
How much you think it made, though? This is fun now.
$1.5 million.
What you think, Nathan?
I'm gonna be generous. The video game has fans, so I'm gonna say $5 million.
$1.7 million.
Wow, I really overbid. I'm not going to the showcase.
So it did go to the theater. Just nobody went to see it.
Yeah.
Wow.
Three people.
Didn't have as many fans as.
So Jin makes out with his girlfriend for a bit, and they're interrupted by Josh Folan and his crew.
Yeah.
And they're invading all these, all these insurgents and killing people. And at one point, they invade the revolution hideout that he went to earlier. And
because they're hacking the Tekken. Hack the Tekken!
He also has one of the worst lines in this movie when he's about to kill the guy, and he said, "The revolution will not be televised."
Bah, 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 bah.
I love that.
He was the bass player in Hardcore Logo. Fun little interesting tidbit.
Ooh, Josh Folan?
No, the leader of the resistance, the one that Jin sells the 20,000 gigabytes.
Yeah,
fucking Jesus.
So we learn quickly that Josh Folan doesn't really give a rat's ass about his own crew because he launches a rocket attack and kills Jin's mom, but also kills a lot of his own men. And
also destroys $100 worth of coffee.
Yeah.
That bastard.
But now
that's the unforgivable.
And an orange.
Really.
And an orange.
I'm assuming though now is when the Jin becomes the Jin from Wishmaster and starts granting some evil wishes.
References.
We got him. Jin is very sad, and we get a lot of flashbacks to his mom's training with him. Actually, throughout the movie, multiple times.
Yeah.
To the point where I was like, enough.
Did you get it? You needed to get it.
It took me 14 times, but at minute 56, I think I got it.
See, there you go. The movie did its job, Brendan. It's fine.
But then it did it, you know, seven times too many.
Well, ask for the person in the back, though.
What? They can't see as well?
No, they got. They hard
making out during the boring parts.
Yeah, they fucking.
They're fucking.
Oh, what kind of movie theaters you think this went to, Brent?
Yeah, the one that Pee Wee was at.
Well, Pee-wee wasn't fucking by himself.
He was fucking his hand. I see that, Brendan. He tried to.
There you go. But he starts searching the rubble, and he finds like his mom's stash. I'm surprised there wasn't porn in it, but he finds her stash, and there's a like a Tekken employee badge in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he figures out, oh, she didn't want me to get involved in Tekken. But wait a second, she was involved in Tekken. Oh, look at Brent.
That lying bitch. I got to get involved in Tekken.
Brent has a fucking Tekken badge.
I got a Tekken badge.
Look at that shit. So, Brent, don't ever tell me not to get involved in Tekken, because I know you were involved.
Don't worry about it, Brendan. You can get involved all you like. I won't stop you.
Oh, thanks, Brent. So he goes full.
He's so mad he even tears the Hihachi poster.
He does. He goes full Anakin rage. I guess I was just calling him Mishima for a while, but it's Hihachi Mishima is his full name.
That's right.
He goes to. We cut to a scene where this guy, Steve, played by Luke Goss.
Fox.
Is it Steve Fox? Okay. He's a character in the game, too. I looked it up.
Oh, and there's a weird thing about. They fuck up so many of these characters. I can't wait to tell y'all about it later on.
I'm all ears, buddy. But Steve Fox is like, hey, I'm going to grant 100 global bucks to anyone who can take down our fighter. Martial law.
Yeah.
And this is an open call to get into Tekken, too.
Yes.
Into Tekken as well, not Tekken, not Tekken the sequel.
This
right?
isn't like an audition for the second Tekken movie. We're
going to have an open call audition in the middle of the filming of the movie, and we're going to leave it in.
We're just going to leave it in.
That's kind of what the Mortal Kombat movie was, an audition to get to the tournament in the sequel.
I won't. Okay. See? Yeah. See? No, that does make some solid sense.
That movie so hard.
Brendan, you loved it. Stop lying.
You don't even. Garbage. You didn't Garbage. Even love it.
Brent. I didn't love it. I will admit that. I did kind of like it, though, because. God. I'm just that easy of a sucker for Mortal Kombat stuff.
Fueled by soiled diapers.
I gave Annihilation an 8 out of 10, so what do I know, yeah?
You what?
Mortal Kombat Annihilation is an easy 8 out of 10, and the first one's a 10+. I'll stand by those scores all day, day.
You movie slut, you.
That's right, and I gave Street Fighter, Van Damme, a 9 out of 10 back in 2018. I stand by my scores.
I like that.
See, there we go.
I think I gave it a head trauma
I saw that opening night when it was released in theaters. So
yeah. There you go. See, we got taste. Brendan is tripping.
So they start lining people up. They start lining people up to take on martial law. There's this big roadhouse looking motherfucker, and he's like, aren't you? Are you scared? And Jin is like, no. And he's like, I am. Bye.
That was funny. No, I do.
That was the best part. Then. I learned that Tekken is apparently affiliated with WWE at the speed in which they show their instant replays.
Yeah.
Jin gets in the ring with martial law. They have a fight. It's not very interesting. I don't think anyway. It goes on for a while. And then eventually Jin beats him.
I think it's also, we do get the idea that everybody in the bar apparently knows Jin because they're watching it on TV. And they're like, hey guys, it's Jin. Yeah, it's Jin. Hey, look, it's Jin. Go, Jin. I'm wondering, while all the rest of this movie is happening and Jin is involved in the tournament, everybody is sitting around that bar going, hey guys, where's Jin?
Yeah.
It's like the Poochie of Tekken.
Yeah.
If he's not on screen, everybody should be asking, where's Jin?
I thought you were going to say that the bartender was freaking out, being like, oh, man, I got to make all these gins. Everybody keeps requesting it. What am I going to do?
I'm running out of alcohol. Nathan, that's why. The people love him.
Well, I love gin as well.
Oh, yeah, I like whiskey, but you know.
You know what's hilarious is they call – so after Jin wins this fight, he ends up getting the nickname the People's Choice.
Yeah.
And what I wrote –
just like Jin.
Well, what I wrote down is if this was wrestling and the promoter gave him that nickname, he would get the shit boot out of him all the time.
If he's the People's Choice, I think Mr. – Dwayne Johnson would have a thing or two to say about it.
That too.
Should just put The Rock in the movie.
The Rock could have played Jin.
There you go. Fuck it.
That would have been interesting.
Why
but
not?
As a really little underdog role.
Yeah. He's like a foot and a half taller than Marshall. I don't know. I'm going to beat this guy.
This guy's. But the whole time The Rock is doing it like, this guy's scary. Guys, don't tell me you wouldn't watch that.
I'll watch it. I watch this. Fuck it.
So Steve Fox,
it considerably, so.
Steve Fox is very impressed by Jin, and he's like, listen, you gotta have like sponsors and shit. I'll take care of all the nitty gritty details. And I gotta tell you right now, when he made that offer, me first time watching this movie, no knowledge of the game, like Brent has said, it doesn't matter.
It don't matter, yeah.
I thought Steve Fox was gonna be a villain at this point. I was like, oh.
I thought there was gonna be a double cross myself.
Yeah, like for sure. I was like, oh, he's gonna turn on him at some point or take all his money.
You're thinking way too hard, Brent.
I know, I'm giving this too much credit. We cut to Josh Folan having sex with two girls, a la Patrick Bateman. Putting Patrick
and giving
Bateman,
himself like a self-hate talk.
Oh, right. Putting Patrick Bateman to shame, though, with all the like, oh, I'm gonna kill this guy, I'm gonna win Tekken, I'm gonna take over, blah, blah, blah. And these girls are like, we're just trying to suck your dick and you're pretty soft right now. So you wanna like concentrate maybe?
No, what? He's hard as fuck. What are you talking about? He's getting hype.
I don't know.
You ain't never gave yourself a little self hate to get the dick hard, Brennan. This is what?
You worthless human being. You pile of protoplasm. I'm ready to go.
You ain't shit. You trash. Ping. There you go.
Squirt.
That squirts.
Fuck.
So we then spend an eternity going through all the participants. So I'll just list right now. And Brent, I want you to tell me how accurate.
Oh, this is so much fan service.
Oh, yeah. 100%. Yeah. This is all it is because most of these characters we barely see.
Yes.
But, Brent, tell me, just brief little interludes, how accurate these characters are. Ready? We got Raven.
Pretty much. Yeah.
Okay.
They don't really do much with him, though.
We got Eddie Gordo.
That motherfucker looks just like him, I'll say that. And his plot is like,
We got the guy that, to me, looked like Jeff Hardy, Sergey Dragunov.
They don't do much with him, so it's hard to say. He's Russian. They got that right, I guess.
We've got the sister assassins, Anna and Nina Williams.
All right. Now we got something to talk about here. All right.
Okay.
Steve Fox, in the video games, is Nina's son. So, yeah. And not only, he's also her genetically engineered son. She didn't give birth to him. Nina was, I think, maybe in Tekken 3, they fucked around with her and they, like, took part of her and cloned a son out of her DNA to, like, do experiments on. And that was Steve Fox. And Steve Fox was a boxer, too, if I remember right.
So he shouldn't even be in this movie because in the line of Tekken, his movie hasn't come out
yet. Exactly. And that's why I thought it was so funny. When that motherfucker said, Steve Fox, I burst out laughing. I was like, no, the fuck you're not.
we've got Christy Monteiro.
That is what I was talking about before. This, in the video game, she is an Afro-Brazilian woman, and she is white as fuck here. Mm-hmm. Another time where I burst out laughing, she was also trained by Eddie Gordo, if I remember right. Or she, some with her and Eddie in the video game. I can't remember now. It's been too long. Tekken 4, but...
Were they both capoeira?
There you go.
We've got Miguel Rojo.
Admittedly, as much as I love Tekken, I don't think I ever really played with this character. So I don't remember who the fuck this is.
he's not M. Bison.
He's the first person that Jin fights, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Balrog. He's the Balrog of Tekken.
We've got...
He's a boxer. No one uses him.
Yeah, I never
do. We've got this swordsman, Yoshimitsu.
Actually, pretty... on point with the suit and everything.
The suit looked really good, but it led me to question the same thing that I questioned when I played the video game. Why does he get a full suit of armor and a sword?
Yeah, exactly.
It's a long story. There's shit with it. There's a doctor that experiments. He's like got cybernetic parts and everything. There's a doctor named Dr. Baskanovich and all this other shit.
Yeah. But he shouldn't be allowed to fight in a tournament where people just have their human skin.
I mean... he got a sword, too.
And a sword. It's the armor I can forgive. It's the sword that really does it for me. He's the only one with a weapon.
That's because, see, he's also part of a game series called Soul Calibur where everybody has weapons, so he got to bring his weapon over to Tekken, too. Okay.
But going into this
movie... But when he does fight people, they actually do get weapons in this movie.
It was wild, though, when that fight happens and they both get a sword. And I was like, wait, what?
Yeah.
Is this a sword fight all of a sudden? Okay, and the last...
Brian Fury.
One of my favorite characters to play as in the video game. Also, half cyborg or whatever, because in the video game, I think his name is Dr. Abel.
Spoiler
Cause,
alert.
Because your boy, he was like Interpol, one of those fucking government places, and got lit the fuck up, and they brought him back through cybernetics, and that's why he's all
He's RoboCop.
There you go, RoboCop.
Yeah.
After we get the introduction of everyone, we get some very homoerotic close-ups of pecs and butts and,
yeah!
and pecs and everything.
Just like the opening of the Big Hit.
Yeah, well,
oh, I gotta
more so
that.
Last week, but definitely some in this one. I also, okay, so now a question. So Jin is walking around. He starts talking to Christy Montiero, and I'm like, why are we developing chemistry between these two? Did we not just see him with his girlfriend who very clearly did not die in that explosion?
Did you not listen yes. to Beyonce when she told you about upgrading Brendan? That's what we're doing right now. We upgrading. To the left, like, to the left.
I feel like the movie, I feel like the filmmaker was like, forgot to cut that scene out where he had a girlfriend at home. Like, I feel like that was, because it's such a quick scene and it doesn't matter.
I don't think he could afford to cut it because this is not a very long movie
it's
at
like
all.
91 minutes. Minutes. 91?
Yeah.
91.
So right there, we're like, oh, okay, I guess these two are eventually going to be an item. The yeah. fighters are all introduced to the world, and we get some more sexual patter, I guess, between Jin and
Wait,
Christy.
He's complimenting
and
our toes.
Jin's kind of a foot guy.
Yeah.
He's a yeah.
Yeah. She also says, like, you can check my ass out when I'm out there fighting. And he's like, oh, shit.
I will.
We're actually going to see the tournament. So it's better than the new Mortal Kombat again.
Jesus.
You just love
set pieces and all.
Yeah. Well, fake backgrounds, yes.
That was weird.
That was so weird.
Hey, that's kind of cool, though. I give them props for that. Because the whole movie looked like fake-ass Running Man, but they still got the video game levels in there somehow. They thought about that shit.
But they looked fake. But they were fake as shit. They were fake as shit.
Well, I mean, yeah.
So our first fight is Raven and Eddie Goro. Or Eddie Gordo, not
Goro.
Goro. And,
you just got Mortal Kombat on your mind.
I don't know. It's a fight. It's pretty boring. It's not shot very well. And Raven wins.
Raven wins.
Nobody dies. He just wins. Even flow DDT.
Even flow DDT.
Yeah.
it was weird that the flock interfered. I didn't think they were allowed to get involved. Jin, the people's choice, by the way. Again, the gimmick that gives you babyface Roman Reigns heat, I would think.
That's right.
Faces Miguel Rojo, or Royo. And I don't know.
I thought they were pronouncing it was spelled with two O's, but I thought they were pronouncing it Roja.
They kept
were
saying they? Roja, yeah.
Okay, because yeah. I thought it was Rojo, and that's why
it was.
It was. But everyone was saying Roja.
Okay, because they didn't bother to learn pronunciation. Got it.
Exactly.
So they fight for a while. My favorite thing about this whole fight, though, isn't even any of the actual moves in the fight. It's the cutback to the bar where they're cheering, and the one guy that took Lenny Kravitz's wardrobe is just like, hit him. that's his whole thing. Hit him.
Hit him. Hit him now.
There were several times when they would cut back to the bar when Jin was fighting and stuff. I'd be like, he can't hear you.
Jin.
Yeah.
Just spirit.
Oh, man. So Jin loses his cool during the fight and almost bashes this guy's face into a paste. So our hero, ladies and gentlemen, Josh Folan doesn't like this too much though. And Mishima is like, "Ooh, you feel a little threatened by this fighter?" And he's like, "No," like Shooter McGavin style, right?
Yeah.
We get a little, so many references in this episode.
Oh, fucking episode.
We get a little standoff, because Jin basically tells like Josh Folan, he's like, you know, I'm not doing this to win Tekken. I'm no company man. I'm out here representing your corporation. Also, on an unrelated note, can I meet your dad in person? I'm totally not gonna kill him. And
nah, it's an autograph.
Yeah, and Josh Folan's like, well, you will if you win. Denied.
I got fun stuff to tell you about these characters too, but I think I'll wait on this one.
Okay. he starts doing some searching of his own because he's like, this Jin guy looks familiar. And he finds out who his mother is and he finds out that she's the one he killed earlier. Now, that's gonna develop a
and
bit more
also
later.
Something else.
Mm-hmm. Well, not yet.
Yes, that's when he figures it out.
Yeah, there's
but
a DNA test.
We don't figure it out yet.
We don't figure it out. They don't tell us directly, but that's when he figures it out.
Well, yeah, but we don't know yet. So we'll hold off on that reveal for now.
Okay.
But he definitely knows that he's the one that, you know, killed this guy's mother.
Sorry.
meanwhile, Christy is definitely hot for Jin. She invites him out on the town, takes him to the club. They start dancing.
It's good to see that late 2000 pop was still popular way in the future after the apocalypse.
Oh, yeah.
It will persevere, guys.
Yeah, right.
Brendan, I do like Jin.
I actually titled this section of the movie "Dirty Dancing Tekken Nights."
Well, I was gonna say, Jin dances like I dance when I go to the club. I'm just gonna sway my body a little bit to the left.
Like, right. He didn't get drunk and fall down and kind of shit himself.
Oh, damn, Brendan, you out there going hard?
Not at all. I barely move when I'm.
That's how it's supposed to be. Gangsters don't dance. We boogie, Brendan. That's what you tell them next time.
Yeah, I'm a gangster.
That's right. Word life.
Word chain to your mother. Basic thugonomics.
That's right. All my gangsters
you
come
from John
Cena.
You can't see me.
You cannot see.
You cannot seeth me.
What, is Shakespeare now?
Yeah. That's when all that screening country movies and shit.
So they start making out on the dance floor.
Yeah.
And I was like, at this point, I'm like, all right, I guess he doesn't have a girlfriend anymore.
Brendan, she died.
She doesn't die. She comes back
later.
She got
blown up. No, that was just why it looked like her. It's fine.
Comes back at the end of the movie.
Brendan.
So have you tried this on other people before, Brent, like with yourself?
Yes.
That wasn't me.
Didn't listen to Shaggy back in the day?
I know the song, yes.
Hey, I guess where I got my dating lessons from. That's why I'm single.
deny.
That's right, it wasn't me. No, that ain't you. No, I ain't got no girlfriend. Me. What
are you talking about?
Yeah.
So they're making out pretty intensely. They get back to the place. They weren't allowed to leave, by the way, so they're pretty rebellious. But they get back to the rooms that they're in, and she's like, I gotta go. No, I gotta go. I can't stay. And then as soon as she leaves, fucking lights start flashing, and Jin is attacked by an assassin or two. And they have a couple swords. Christy hears the commotion, comes back, smashes the window, and comes back in, but the assailants have fled. Who could have done this? Who?
You.
Who?
All these damn wrestling references, nerds.
I mean, the movie makes it pretty clear that it was Josh Folan that sent these assassins after Jin.
Yes. Well,
it's not the most well-kept secret.
You know who it really was? It was that girlfriend you keep speaking of.
Oh, she's the mastermind.
See?
Because she's not dead. She's pulling the strings behind the scenes.
Pull the strings!
Jesus Christ. Yeah, okay, all right. Fucking nerds.
Yeah. Word life.
Thugonomics. What?
Calling a nerd, I'm sitting here with a fucking Gamera sticker and a Spider-Ham symbiote costume sticker on my drink container.
We're all nerds. It's fine. I'm out here giving Tekken factoids.
Interesting tidbits.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, that's right.
Josh Folan is annoyed with the ladies for the failed assassination, says, you know, I got to clean up your mess now.
With the ladies?
With the ladies. We got two ladies, Nina and Anna. Anna?
Yes.
Nina and Anna Williams. Were the assassins earlier, guys. And
what?
Josh Folan's not too happy with them. Yeah, I know, big twist, Shyamalan style. And so we cut to the next fight. Christy Monteiro versus Nina Williams.
And I was hoping that this match was going to end with a signature move called pussyfooting around.
Yeah.
Where Montanaro just kicks Nina right in the box.
Right in the pussy. Pussy galore.
Kick her right in the pussy. But what happens is there's a great dialogue exchange where Nina Williams pretty much gives it away that she was one of the assassins by saying, I like your boyfriend. He's cute. To which Christy says, what does she say?
Fuck, I don't remember.
Sorry, I don't share.
Ah.
And then she beats her ass and wins.
That's right. Beat that ass.
We finally get some bit of Brian Fury, the character that Brent really likes, he said.
Yeah.
And Josh Folan is like blackmailing him because he knows he's like half robot. And he's like, that's illegal in Tekken. So I'm going to tell you what, you better kill Jin. Here's a payoff.
But full suits of armor and a sword. Perfectly fine.
Yep.
Perfectly fine.
Perfectly fine, but don't be a robot. It's
Soul Calibur rules, Nathan. It's fine.
It's the post-apocalyptic racist world, guys.
See, if they had all thought to bring swords, they'd have been fine, but they weren't thinking. So you got to get ahead.
What were they thinking, Brent?
Exactly. They weren't.
And thank you, folks.
So Jin is
matched weird up. If that's how that were like the rules for our podcast. Somebody just said that, then all of a sudden everything just cut off, and that's the episode that everybody gets for the week.
Outro music.
The program just stops recording. So Jin is matched up next with Yoshimitsu. We get some more struggle between Mishima and his son because Josh Folan is like, or Mishima is like, ah, this is better suited for the semifinals. Let's shake that randomizer up again. And Josh Folan's like, no, now I'm mad. Now I'm taking over. And he commands his security team to...
Because he's the head of security.
Security to basically... He basically stages a coup a la January 6th to take over Tekken.
No, his was mostly successful.
Take that.
And he faced consequences. Well, we're still waiting, but yeah, we'll see.
We're still waiting on that, yeah.
But anyway, he takes over Tekken, and we get the fight between Jin and Yoshimitsu because he orders it to commence. And this is the weird part where, oh, we're just having a sword fight in this one. Not with our dicks, but with swords.
Aww.
But Yoshimitsu...
He saw where you were going with that right away, Brent. He knew he had to interject.
He's learning too well.
I'm adapting. Yeah. But Yoshimitsu does have full armor, and Jin is literally just wearing pants. Like the loosest
pants. Hey, that's a good-ass pants,
signature
though.
Pants.
Yeah. I mean, no cheap pants.
They fight for a while. Meanwhile, we find out that Josh Folan is... guys, big reveal. He's Jin's father.
Dun, dun, dun.
All right, can I interject some Tekken knowledge for you real quick?
This is exactly like the video game?
No, actually.
What?
He is Jin's son. Or sorry, his dad in the video game. Sorry, I had that backwards. But the whole plot of the video games, pretty much throughout like all seven of them, is that Kazuya, or would you keep calling him Josh Brolin?
Josh Brolin, yeah.
And Heihachi like have massive beef because when Kazuya was a kid, Heihachi threw him off a cliff and was basically like, hey, if you're strong enough to get back up off this cliff, you're my son. Fuck you. And when he was down there, he ended up basically unleashing the devil gene inside him, so then he would turn into like this little devil character. And so they have beef where they're just trying to kill each other over and over again, because at the end of the first Tekken game, Kazuya throws Heihachi off the same cliff. Tekken 2 starts with Heihachi climbing up the cliff, and then Tekken 2 ends with Heihachi beating Kazuya and I think throwing him in a volcano or some shit, but he's not dead because he'll come back in like Tekken 4. But then Tekken 3 introduces Jin, who now has to fight a motherfucker named Ogre that killed his mom, because Ogre killed Jun in the fucking
Shrek?
Video game. Yes! Well, he had to fight True Ogre.
No, actually, no, it's the guy from Revenge of the Nerds.
Oh, Booger.
Never seen
no,
that.
No, Ogre.
Oh, I'm thinking of, who am I thinking of? Booger. Who's that?
Booger is in Revenge of the Nerds, but Ogre is the big frat guy.
Oh, the one that's
Revenge
like,
of the Nerds.
Nerds!
Okay. Yeah. Ah. Jackson from Bloodsport.
Sure.
Oh, there we go. Oh. See, now we're talking the movie I know. Never seen Revenge of the Nerds. But yeah, I was to say all that to just say that this shit where it's like there's him and his dad just beefing over a company is like some bullshit because they wanted to kill each other in the video games. And they were throwing each other off fucking cliffs, which I would have loved. That's how this movie should have ended. Just throw everybody off a fucking cliff.
And surprise, it's actually an adaptation of Lemmings.
There you go.
Or that documentary that Disney made about Lemmings.
Wait, what?
Which is why in the game Lemmings, you have to stop Lemmings from jumping off a cliff.
Oh.
See?
Yep.
So, anyway, it's his father. Josh Folan is Jin's father in a reveal with considerably less drama than The Empire Strikes Back. But Mishima is being held at bay, but he does manage to set off an alarm, and the distraction allows Jin to murder Yoshimitsu. He, like, fucking hits him in the heart so hard, and I think he, like, stops his heart or something. Right?
I mean, y'all complained about that armor, see, it didn't help, see?
Well, because he's got the heart punch.
Yeah, he got them gloves.
Yeah, he's got gloves. Right, he's got those gloves on. So he punches Yoshimitsu and kills him, and then Josh Folan is very mad, but he learns, oh, murder equals ratings, and he goes down and talks to the fighters, and he's like, you know what? From now on, it's kill or be killed. And again,
well,
guys...
He has all the fighters detained at this point, too, doesn't he?
Yes. And again, at this point, when he says kill or be killed, I'm like... Wasn't that what you fucking said at the beginning of the movie?
Brent,
it made me go, you know what? This is exactly how GCW is booked. The top of the card is always death matches.
There you go.
The fighters that are down there, they don't like this shit, and they manage to overpower some of the guards and open fire, and they attempt to escape the prison. They end up finding Mishima, who's like, you know, I'm on your side now, even though Jin is like, I'm gonna murder you, because he blames him, you know, for his mother's death. And being like, you know, the head of Tekken, he thinks Mishima is evil. Spoiler alert, he's not that evil. And that's in the game, right? He's a good guy.
Not that evil.
In the video game, kind of evil, though. In the game, he fucking murdered his wife. And like, this is an evil motherfucker.
I think in the movie, though, they really do say he's like a good... The reveal is that he's a good guy.
And that's why I'm saying this movie has nothing to do with those fucking video games.
But Mishima is like, listen, I can get you access codes. I can get you guys out of here. I wrote down, did they just leave every other fighter to die? Because suddenly it's just like Jin, Steve, Christy.
I thought Raven was dead because I thought he got shot during the...
I think he did.
The getaway.
I missed that.
I thought he was dead.
He was like leaking in the cell, wasn't he? Am I tripping?
Something like that.
Yeah.
What was up with those weird wedge cells too?
It's future. It's the future, Nathan. That's how it's gonna look.
Yeah. Okay. So we gotta make the all the holding cells look like wedges. Okay.
Yeah. It's the future.
Again, Nathan with the Final Fantasy VII references. Biggs and Wedge. I like it.
Ooh. Somebody's been playing a lot of Final Fantasy VII out here.
I'm more of a Final Fantasy IX guy.
Oh,
actually.
You're one of those people.
What do you mean by those people?
I like that game too. I can't tell.
So Jin and Mishima start talking back and forth, and they're talking about, you know, they're debating the positives and the negatives of Tekken. And Mishima's like, listen, I'm the one who actually saved your mom, all right? I pulled her out of Tekken, and I saved her life. And he's like, I've never wanted to use Tekken to, like, you know, do anything evil. We're helping society and blah, blah, blah. But then he reveals that Josh Folin is his father, and Jin, of course, is like, liar!
He's super rapey.
And he's like, liar!
Really, really rapey.
That's impossible! Oh, wait, that's a different movie, sorry.
a worse movie.
What?
I just want to stir some shit real quick.
Empire Strikes Back?
The second best Star Wars movie.
I'm just using PJ logic out here. I'm speaking for PJ. Oh, I think he did give this a better score than Empire Strikes Back when we did it, I think.
Oof.
He gave that shit a 5. I know that. I think he gave this higher than a 5.
He tells him that, you know, Josh Folin's his dad and he's his grandfather. And like Nathan said, Josh Folin is super rapey. And the reason he's his dad is because he raped Jin's mother. This is, again, all this stuff is delivered in the span of, I don't know, 2.5 minutes.
And I'm watching this, and I was not aware of the rich lore of Tekken.
That apparently has nothing to do with Tekken.
None of this shit.
Yeah, made up whole cloth.
he definitely was not a rapist in the video game, I'll say.
At least not to your knowledge. Could have been
at least not. I mean, that might have been a cutscene I didn't unlock or something. I don't know.
That's right, it's rated M for mature.
That's right. That one Tekken game.
If you defeat Yoshimitsu in the palace, you'll unlock this rape scene. I think I'm just going to not play that level.
Yeah, you got to put in the naked code, like Tomb Raider.
So bad guys show up out of nowhere like a diamond cutter. Hey. Much fighting ensues.
I thought it was an ace crusher.
Steve Fox is killed, guys. He's shot in the chest. Goodbye, Steve Fox.
Bye.
Josh Folin walks up to all this carnage and he corners Mishima and he says, you know, a Tekken is in my hands. And I say, I said, I don't see a video game cartridge in his hands. but he says, you know, Tekken's mine. Mishima tells him, you're going to fail no matter what. It doesn't matter. And Josh Folin is like, I'm giving the order. He's like, you had to destroy everything, including Mishima. So Mishima gets down on his knees. He says, I am Tekken, and waits for the guard to execute him. Cut away. Because we hear, like...
I actually, at this point, I noted, for a guy who is, like, a renowned fighter, he sort of just kind of took it.
Well, it's all about honor.
Yeah.
But the funniest thing about this scene...
Product in your hair.
The funniest thing about this scene is they cut away, and... Because we definitely wouldn't just get it, seeing this guy put a gun to his chest and about to shoot and hear a gunshot off screen. No, we have to hear Josh Folin walking away saying, Mishima is dead. But he doesn't even say it like that. He's like, Mishima is dead. And I'm like, yeah.
He's dead.
Yeah, I watched the last scene, Josh. I know.
but Brendan, did you know?
I knew.
But are you sure?
I knew all. I just saw it happen.
Did the person behind you know?
They were too busy fucking.
Exactly. That's why I had to repeat it.
It just was like, it was the weirdest, like, the movie was like, oh, these people are too stupid to know that this person just died in the scene.
I mean,
the character looks right at the camera and says it.
It is a video game movie, Brennan.
Same video games are dumb.
Yeah, pretty dumb.
Yeah, as I'm coding all these games.
So everyone's fighting to the death now. We get Brian Fury versus Jeff Hardy. Brian Fury, there's like a chain, and there's like a, what does he have? Does he have like a sword too?
No, I don't know what the fuck this whole thing was, because I thought he decapitated the dude.
I thought so too.
But he didn't.
No. He just like, he puts a chain around Jeff Hardy's neck and he pulls it like you're pulling it to like, you know, the head's off. And then it looked down and it's just blood around his neck. I also questioned like the movie being rated R. Because I was like, it's violent, but it doesn't seem like it ever goes beyond like PG-13 violence.
But it's the amount of PG-13 violence, I think.
Yes,
possibly.
Yeah, it just,
and a couple people do get shot right in the chest.
Yeah,
too.
I mean, I feel like you see that in a Bond movie though. Like, I don't think it feels a very light R.
Light R.
I will take a movie, but please make it a light R.
Light on the R.
No, please, not a lot.
Don't hold it entirely, just light.
Yeah, just a little bit of R. Well, I mean, he had girlies shaking that ass in the club too, Brennan. You know, that's kind of R rated right there.
No, not at all.
A little R.
Then Jin was gonna get lucky with his girlfriend.
That's right.
His girlfriend.
You just admitted he had a girlfriend.
No,
you just admitted
he did. He did, and she got blown up. See.
She didn't. Liar.
I speak the truth.
Wrong.
You sit on a throne of lies.
I speak the truth that nobody wants to speak. It's like Alex Jones out here.
Relax with that now.
I had to do it for Brendan. I had to do it.
Asshat.
Oh. I was about to see Brendan's reaction.
So anyway, back to Tekken. So Josh Folan is basically like, hey, Jin, your mother put up a pretty good fight, and he's being all horrible. And he says, listen, if you don't fight in the tournament, I'm gonna torture Christy. I'm gonna kill her. Raven's not dead, because Raven shows up in this scene.
He's not. That's right. I thought he died. Yeah. But then he shows up later and gives a pep talk.
He gives a pep talk, which is unmotivated by anything.
Yeah.
He's never been a character that's like this. They almost should have just kept Steve Fox's character alive and had him do this scene.
We need a drama, though.
A pep talk from a mentor would have made a lot more sense.
Than just another fighter who he's barely talked to. Yeah.
But they connect, though, because they both fighters. They understand each other, Brendan. This is screenwriting.
Sure, okay, though.
Brent, what's that in the background? Why does it say a check from Tekken Co?
Don't worry about all that.
Don't look at that.
Oh, there's a lot of zeros on that.
Yeah, with nothing in front of them.
I was about to say, unfortunately.
Well, you got fucking tricked then.
I got a copy of the Blu-ray, though. It's fine.
Jesus, of course you do.
man.
So we get the big fight. We get Jin facing Brian Fury, who, of course, is half robot, as we know. Jin actually kicks Fury in the chest, and we totally see his half robotness. He kind of sparks a bit, and we see some silver. Oh, what a cheater. And again, how many fucking times are we going to flash back to his mom's like fucking karate lessons? Like, I get it. She taught him how to fight. Got it. It's
Brendan,
in.
You need to know, though. You need it solidified in your mind.
In case you were busy fucking at the back of the theater.
Exactly.
In the first half of the movie, we want you to remind it that Jin's mom, who was dead and was raped, was the one who trained him.
Exactly. Weed is legal there.
Now that you're post-coital, you know, and everybody's had a mutual orgasm, you can jump right back into the movie, and you're all caught up.
It's kind of fucked up that people were fucking while the reveal about the rape was happening on screen.
They weren't paying attention at that part.
It didn't start there.
Not for everyone.
It just went from this to just like, oh. Then it was like, okay, now we go back to the dance.
All right, it's over. Yep. No, we gotta.
So anywho, this fight is going on. We get that people chanting Jin in the bar, like Nathan said earlier. He can't hear them. It's like when people clap in a movie theater. Have you ever seen that?
Yes.
None of those people are there tonight.
No. Like, the only reason it's ever like, oh, cool, to like clap in a theater is if it's a premiere. if the director is there, if someone from the movie is there, fine.
Yeah.
But like, if you're going to go see
that, just ball up your popcorn bag and put it in the receptacle on the way out.
Yeah, listen, I like Shang-Chi just as much as anyone else, but if I'm not clapping at the end of the movie. I'm just saying it's great.
Unfortunately, Simu Liu was actually there in that theater because he's Canadian.
Oh, damn it.
Oh, shit.
You should have clapped, Brendan. Now you're never going to hear back.
Now he feels bad.
Yeah, now after everybody left, he's just sitting there with a tear coming down his face because of you.
Wiping it off.
And then he's like, oh, right, I was in this movie, and I also did ads for Google, so I'm pretty good.
Yeah. Jin at one point does this huge jumping, like, parkour kick that takes down Brian Fury, and yes. this I guess, finishes him off. wording.
Yeah, you gotta get finished.
We do cut to his at-home girlfriend. We do cut to his at-home girlfriend who's cheering him on.
Who's cheering, and she's got like this absolute look of amazement, like, my boyfriend, who's totally gonna marry me when he gets back to town, has just become the people's champion.
And I wrote down, she is gonna be so disappointed when she finds out he's fucking Christy.
Oh, and don't they kiss on camera at some point?
Yeah.
Yeah. Upgrade you, girl.
And she's like, motherfucker.
It's just like, that's... you know, anybody gets famous, they go get a little celebrity girl. And it's like, hey, you know, our time is over. Your watch has ended.
Guys, that would have been Tekken 2. That would have been the sequel.
There is a sequel to
Curly's
this.
Gold?
Hey.
The legend of whatever that girl's name is, Gold.
The legend of Jin's ex-girlfriend.
It's Gold.
It's Gold. Oh, shit.
So Josh Folin is real upset, and he's like, that's it. I'm going to fucking kill him. And even more than Yoshimitsu, he just grabs a couple of axes, and I'm like, well, this is a super unfair fight.
She just grabbed a gun.
Right? And just shot him. The end of the movie.
Bam, bam. See? I own Tekken now.
So, yeah, shoot all of them.
So Jin is fighting Josh Folin. He's going at him with the axes. Jin actually manages to take... I think he manages to steal one at one point, and they're kind of having an axe fight. But there's
axes
a distraction.
To grind.
There you go. There's a distraction from the booth, though, because Christy is all, like, kidnapped, but she starts fucking up the guards. And this allows Jin to slice Folin right across the belly, but stops short of murdering him. But he wins. He wins, damn it.
Jin wins.
And then I'm so glad, guys, how convenient was it that when Christy came down, she was mic'd up and she was able to announce him as the winner?
Yeah.
Well, she was in the sound room. We just pick up a microphone.
Why the fuck would she
grab
be mic'd?
A mic on your way
no,
out.
No, but she was lavaliered up. Like, she didn't just have a microphone. Somebody had to, like, mic her up.
Brendan, she ain't new to this. She true to this. She know what she doing.
God damn it.
In all fairness, Jin is the only real newcomer to... the tournament.
That's true.
Everybody else has been in the tournament before. They may actually make a big deal out of it because Jin is a newcomer. He actually defeated Martial Law, who had been previously in Tekken. So Brent actually might make a good point where she is, as she knows how this goes, you need to be mic'd if you're going to cut a
promo.
There
you go.
This ain't her, this is not a Sid Vicious situation where he's like, ah, crap, can we do that again?
We're live, pal.
You know, Mishima has to go, we're live, pal.
I don't remember what I was going to say. I had something.
Well, that's kind of it.
So
that's the end of it.
So she announces him as the winner, and Tekken, and basically says, you know, Tekken can come together. There's unicorns and rainbows everywhere. Tyranny is defeated. We're all great. Everything's fun. There was one point where they cut back to the bar, and the bartender says, drinks on the house. And then another guy says, no, drinks on me. And I'm like, dude, they offered drinks on the house.
Dumbass.
What are you doing, stupid? Stupid shit.
Stupid fuck.
So Jin goes home. He's like marching with all these other like resistance people, I guess.
Yeah.
And then we see his fucking at-home girlfriend just like in the corner. And that's the moment, guys. That's the moment where she looks and she starts devising her evil plan. Tekken 2, The Revenge of Jin's Ex.
Is Gold.
It's Gold. The Revenge of Jin's Ex's Gold.
You know what the actual title of the sequel is? You're not far off.
Tekken 2, The Revenge of Mishima.
It's Tekken 2, Kazuya's Revenge.
Ah.
Okay.
Because he doesn't die. He just gets sliced a little bit and put into prison. Now, the weirdest thing...
It's a prequel. It's not even a sequel.
Oh, wonderful. So we get to see that rape scene that they talk about.
How do you have a revenge in a prequel?
Don't worry. You know...
You haven't been wronged yet.
You gotta watch it on the show now. You got to find out. Yeah.
Okay, so...
Come on, Listener's Choice Month.
I have issues with the wording in general and the fact that it's a prequel, but it's somebody's revenge.
Weirdest thing next, though, is when they have the closing credits, everyone's credited as their character's name. I thought that was pretty weird. Because usually, you know, you have the opening credits and you see, like, the actor and then you see a couple quick shots of what they did. But it's like, no, it's like Kazama. It's like Mishima. And I'm like, wait, what? Give the fucking actors their credit.
They got paid. It's fine. Nobody saw this.
That's like the thing in that new Space Jam where they were like, Bugs Bunny as himself. I'm like, fuck off. Put the person that actually does his fucking voice.
You mean another great movie?
Oh, shut up. Guys, I don't know about you. This is the end of the movie. Did anyone skip to the end credits?
I didn't. I forgot to do that.
Oh, yeah. You did?
I did. I watched it, yeah.
Because there's your sequel tease. Because we cut back to the scene where Mishima was we thought, executed.
I am Tekken.
I am Tekken. The guard lowers his gun and does not shoot him. Oh, when's that sequel coming?
Never.
I was actually hoping for an actual post-credit scene with Gon, the little dinosaur.
Oh, I would have loved it. You needed Gon, Alex, and Roger.
He just shows up.
Well, guys, that's Tekken.
All right, just a second.
Oh, there you go.
So... I will go around the horn. I will start with our guest, Brent.
Hey.
Was this movie worth a watch? A drunk watch with friends? Would you attempt head trauma to forget it or avoid it like the plague?
I can say this from personal experience because we've done this multiple times. This is definitely a drunk watch with friends. I've watched this movie a bunch of times. I wasn't joking. I own the Blu-ray. I remember that this had to come out actually on DVD at least in 2010 because I didn't know it was a thing until I saw a Blu-ray coming out. And I went to this Best Buy immediately to get me a copy of it, and I loved it back in the day when I was like 19.
You were the only person there that day to buy a copy.
You damn right, and I still got it, and I got Tekken 2 over here somewhere. I got all of the Tekken movies here at the house. So yeah, it's a drunk watch.
All right, well, Nathan, what say you, buddy?
Yeah, I'd say it's a drunk watch with friends. Yeah. I like I said, I did enjoy it. I liked it maybe just a little bit more than the Van Damme Street Fighter movie, but
blasphemy,
like by just a little bit. I feel the production values on this one were just a little bit better than the Van Damme Street Fighter,
which is crazy because I think that movie has a much bigger budget.
It does, but it's also like
it was the 90s too, though.
It was 15 years before almost. So
still,
but yeah, drunk watch with friends. Yeah.
Okay.
What about you, man?
I'm going to go in the middle of two of these categories. I'm going to, because it didn't quite have enough, like, holy shit, hilarious moments for me to quite say drunk watch with friends. But it also wasn't like, it was not as horrible as I expected.
No.
Because I thought it.
So you're saying it's a drunk watch with friends, but fall down and get a head injury. So you kind of forget some of it.
Right.
Somewhere get so between... drunk you don't remember.
Exactly. You won't remember because most of this movie has slid off my brain.
If you're going to want to remember this, you're going to want to take notes.
But we're going to take a brief break. We're going to hear from some sponsors, and we will be right back. What were they thinking? NPR bot, initiate.
Beep.
Beep. Thank you. All right. It is time for the low haiku. Mm-hmm. Nathan. Oh, Brent. Oh, we got some nice NPR voices going around the table here.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. That's right. So Nathan, why don't you explain to the folks exactly what is the low haiku?
Well, the low haiku is 17 perfect syllables to describe the movie that we've just been talking about for an hour and some change.
Mm. All right. And as our guest, Brent, would you like to start us off with your low haiku?
Definitely.
Okay.
I. Oh, sorry. Error there. Sorry about that, folks.
It's okay.
What
The Running Man. Wait, maybe it's Blade Runner. I don't know. Fuck it. Thank you.
Thank you. Nathan, would you like to read your haiku?
Yes, I would. Mine is as such. Select your fighter. Gonna need a drink for this. Please pass me the gin.
Kazama.
That would have interfered with the with this syllable scheduling.
So, so I got you back.
Okay.
Brendan, yes. Would you like to, yes?
I would like to read my haiku. Okay. Fighting tournament that we get to watch in this. That's so hard, MK? Thank you. NPR bot, hurry up.
Beep!
Oh, that was close.
Close.
Klaus.
The fish from American Dad?
Yeah.
Sure. Oh, boy. We talked about this movie. We waxed poetical, but and we had opinions. Slightly differing opinions. But, Nathan, what do we always say on this show?
Well, we are often noted as saying...
Don't take a word for us!
That's right. That's what we say. We say, don't take our word for it, because you shouldn't.
Oh.
Oh, forget about it. But Nathan, I'm assuming thousands of critics watched this and loved it.
No, in fact, Brendan, only 6 reviews for this thing, and it is sitting at the, I guess, often sought after by people like us, 0 on the Rotten Tomatoes.
Oh, big old goose egg. I feel like if they had gotten, right, like 140 reviews, like most mid-level movies, it might not be at a 0.
Yeah, I don't think it would be a whole lot.
Nah, maybe like a 15
or
something.
They don't deserve a 0, though.
It probably wouldn't be at a 0. With only 6 reviews. But I'm assuming the audience, you know, video games, people love video games. Hit me with that 95%.
31%. A 10,000-plus rating.
It looks like they were all written by B. Fullen.
All the positive ones, anyways.
Yeah, all those rotten people were just people that were fucking in the back of the theater.
Don't listen to the haters. but I will say this.
Oh, okay.
If you did enjoy Tekken, and Brent says he did.
I own it.
Yeah, I kind of did too. We might also enjoy Marked for Death.
Yeah.
It's called movie. I kind of like
that's
that too.
That's a shit.
The Corruptor.
Yeah.
Chow Yun-Fat and Mark Wahlberg.
I like these
movies.
On Deadly Ground.
I don't know.
Starring Steven Seagal. It was his last, second to last big theatrical movie.
I think The Glimmer Man was his last theatrical movie.
No, Exit Wounds.
The Glimmer Man was the last one for like a while.
Or Half Past Dead.
Exit
too.
Wounds or Half Past Dead. Half one of those two dead. Ones.
Those were like, yeah, but the, yeah, there was quite a bit of period of time between them, though. I think.
Also, Universal Soldier 2. Brothers in Arms.
Haven't seen the second one.
And Virtuosity, which
y'all need
Ken
to watch
confirmed
that.
Really like that movie.
That also
and
has
we
to be.
Could
yeah,
absolutely do that movie.
It also yeah. has to be a coming soon.
When is that coming up?
spoiler alert, one of those actors might be around soon.
Denzel Washington.
No, definitely not. All right, well, there we go. Good choice of alternate selections to Tekken. So let's get into the critics' reviews here, guys. Our first one comes from Simon Murado from Quick Flicks, who says, the fight sequences, dreamlike and almost spiritual in the original game, are relegated to UFC-style octagons shot like shaky cam snuff and soundtracked by insane clown posse wannabes. It'd be headache-inducing if it weren't so damn boring.
Wow. All right, well, my next one is from Felix Vasquez Jr. from Cinema Crazed, and he writes, if fodder like Best of the Best is your bag, give this a shot. It's not the worst game movie ever made. Dot, dot, dot.
Oh.
Okay.
All right. From David Hogan, Hawk's little cousin. At hoganreviews.co.uk.
Wow, I wonder how he got that gig.
part Hunger Games, part Tournament Fighter film, part faithful game adaptation. You're fucking wrong on that one, sir. Part completely incorrect game adaptation. Oh, well, then I guess I shut the fuck up then, huh? The film is a mess, but can still be entertaining. Dot, dot, dot.
And that's a 3 out of 5. I don't know why that's a negative, actually.
That is kind of weird.
Yeah. All right. And then I guess my last one is from Brian Orndorff of brianorndorff.com. Mr. Wonderful's
Paul's son.
Yeah. Yep. Son.
All these wrestlers.
We got Paul Hogan and Paul Orndorff's kids got into movie reviews. That's interesting.
Yeah. Film criticism was their calling. It does make a plucky attempt to replicate the flippy floppy nature of the fighting elements, creating a limb snapping effort of escapism surrounded by bland writing and sleepy performances.
Mm.
D plus. Oof.
Yeah.
Caffeinated Clint from Media Shark says, it's not that McElroy hasn't crafted an interesting enough storyline in some respects. It's quite an okay plot. But more that he doesn't know how to engage his audience.
Damn. All right, Brent, what's our last critic say?
Yeah, from Sebastian Zavala Khan from Moss Gamers. Mm. Tekken is, at least, the ultimate proof that copying the aesthetics of the video game for a live-action movie doesn't always work. Full review in Spanish.
Thank you for including that.
There you go.
All right. Well, enough of that.
Let's see what the knuckle draggers had to say.
Yeah.
See what the mouth-breathing cretins are saying about this movie. Okay. Well, I'm going to start off with a review from Jake T.
I can only assume that's Jake Tapper.
Yes, from CNN. Jake Tapper gives it 5 stars and says, I kind of felt bad for this movie. I like it. Cool action movie. I don't care. People say they're chickens.
Oh.
And it's their, T-H-E-R-E.
Oh, also, it makes
chickens.
It also makes zero sense. Like, I don't know what that's saying. Other than cool action movie, people say they're chicken. I don't know. I don't know, Jake Tapper. You make a lot more sense on TV when you're speaking. So.
Okay. Let's see. My first one comes from 1S, and he says, not a bad movie. Makes me want to play the video game. 5 out of stars.
Oh.
Okay, one.
He started the review with not a bad movie.
Not a bad movie.
And
perfect
gave it
score.
5 stars. Yeah, exactly.
Yep. from Kirpianicus. Kirpianicus? I don't know how you pronounce this shit.
Okay.
Copernicus?
He, John Fu, he could be the only motif for see the film, not for performance, not for story, who seems do not exist, but only for his physical presence. Sure, for martial arts fans, Tekken is a nice film, maybe. for fans of the game, a must see. I have few doubts about it because it has a story to tell. Because the fragments of story are so bizarre and not more than sketches, then all remains at level of confusion. The film does nothing new or interesting or predictable because it is only another action film with a precise target who gives few fights, a kind of love story, a few crumbs of Star Wars, and this is all. If you ignore John Fu, who maybe could be the reasonable motif to see the film, 2 out of 3 people found that review helpful.
Did that person have an aneurysm while they were writing?
Wow.
I can barely get through it.
Fuck.
God, I love IMDb.
Fu. That's like
oh shit.
That's like when John Rambo does kung fu, right?
Oh, I thought it was when John Woo made a movie, but he didn't want you to know it was him.
That's what I thought too.
I thought this was when John Goodman does kung fu. Okay, so this review. Wow, guys, we have a celebrity in our midst. This review is from Rotten Tea.
Mm.
Ooh,
Rotten Tomatoes themselves. This is a movie I've never seen before and don't really care about it, but I'll give it 5 stars.
There you go.
Okay. This one comes from Justin G. And I'm assuming it's Justin Gabriel.
Mm.
And he writes, awful, .. just god awful. 1.5 out of stars.
Okay.
Not half a star.
No.
Not I wish I could give this zero. God awful. 1.5 out of stars.
1.5.
From Camarai 25, they gave it 5 out of 10. Boring watch. Probably won't watch again. And can't recommend. I tried and fell asleep on this 3 times. There is plenty of things happening, but who cares, really? The movie goes far out of the way to disconnect the audience from the characters, world, and action. Maybe I'll update this if I can ever get through it, but I can't see it being better than what I think it is right now. Unless you're a big Tekken fan, go watch Dead or Alive instead. 1 out of 2 people find our review helpful.
Now it's 2 out of 3.
I liked it, Raj. You said that. Don't worry.
Okay. this review is pretty straightforward from Scott R. He just says, could have been better. 1 star.
Okay. Well, my next one is from Paul H., and I can only assume that's Crocodile Dundee himself, Paul Ooh. Hogan.
He says, and he writes, I wrote this movie. I'm going to sue the writers and put my name on it.
Better than I thought it would be. 4 out of stars.
Wow. Paul Hogan, big fan of Tekken. Okay.
Yeah. She diabolic.
I should have.
Is that like, wait, is that like someone say like she? Oh, her? She diabolic.
Yeah, she underscore diabolic, but diabolic is spelled D-I-A-B-L-O-Y-K.
Oh my God. From she dyslexic.
Hey, explosion. I should have learned my lessons and played the game instead. After Blood Rain, Dead or Alive, and Doom.
Oh!
Trifecta. I gave up hope that the video game to movie adaptation could not be done successfully. In theory, this movie should never have been watched by myself. However, as a longstanding fan of Namco and the Tekken series, I hunted high and low to find and see this movie. I wrote a longer comment, but felt so let down and despondent that I deleted it and concluding with this as my final verdict. Advent Children, in all capital letters, is the greatest movie, or sorry, the greatest game to movie adaptation. There is no other. Let us stop wasting money. Production companies should be sued for false advertising and time wasting. 1 hour and 24 minutes, I will not be getting back this year. 1 out of 2 people found our review helpful.
2 out of 3.
Bam.
I gotta say, obviously, we all know the best video game to movie adaptation is Assassin's Creed. Am I right, fellas?
I have it, but I don't agree.
Oh. I have it. Of course you fucking do.
I got everything.
Wait, do you own a copy of Song of the South?
I have it. We reviewed it on episode 20.
I know
20.
You did.
Review it.
Yeah, I just didn't know if you had a copy of it.
Oh, I don't have a copy. I have a copy bootleg. There you go.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I don't think you can get a copy of it.
If you want a VHS, you can. If you want to pay some money for some racism, you can.
I don't want to pay. I don't pay for my racism.
Yeah, I get it for free every day. Thanks, America.
Brent, the next day, what's the email from M. Taylor Green?
Oh.
She wants to pay a whole lot of money for some racism.
There's a lot of N-words in here.
Brent, I got a question right now. You get an email from that bitch. Marjorie Taylor Greene, she's like, I want to pay you $200,000 for your bootleg of Song of the South. Do you sell it to her?
No.
Oh, wow. Okay.
You know what you do? You make a copy and sell her a bootleg of a bootleg.
No, I'm gonna get a nice label maker. I'm gonna print out a label and everything. And I'm just gonna put that fucking E.T. and Goof Troop porn on there, Brendan. That's what I'm gonna do.
Oh my God.
And Kelsey Monroe.
That's right. Shot and bananas out of her pussy hole.
Actually, wait. Marjorie Taylor Greene doesn't deserve banana porn.
Oh, that's why she got the E.T.
She's getting the E.T. and the Goof Troop porn.
That's right.
All right, he's gone, Goofy. Now fuck his wife.
Exactly. I need to put down a t-shirt someday.
All right. My last audience review, folks, is from Aaliyah B., who gives it 4 out of stars. And Aaliyah says, okay, so there's no punctuation here.
There you go.
It was okay. There's something wrong in the movie. Christy did not have another glove or armband on her other arm, and she did not date Jin in the movie. They didn't a club scene in the game, and why did all the fighters get kidnapped? It was odd.
Okay. Well, my last one comes from Billy B, and I can only assume that's Billy Barty.
Oh no.
and he writes, horrible adaptation of an awesome video game. Plus, it didn't have my favorite fighter, Mokujin.
Oh, I would have loved that.
Other words that I can't say.
Oh.
1.5 out of stars.
When you said the F sound, I was a little scared when Billy Barty was writing the review.
My favorite fighter.
Yeah.
Keep on your toes. All right,
see
I got
our
one
episode on Body Slam, Body Slam for more.
Ah, there you go. I still need to watch
send
that.
Send us home.
One last review. This is a 1 out of 10 from James Earl Cash. No Paul Phoenix. I've never seen this. I was confused about this part. I've never seen this, but I saw that Christopher Daniels is in this movie, and he is delightful. B.U.T. As a big fan of the games, I can't reward any stars except one because zero is not plausible, because there is no Paul Phoenix, who is my favorite character in the entire series. And 0 out of 2 people found our review helpful.
He must have thought Christopher Daniels was Steve Fox.
Oh, okay. So I was trying to think. I was going to ask y'all, like, was he here and I just missed it?
No, he was not. There's no way he's in this movie.
I'm looking right now.
Nathan doing the Googles.
Yeah, well, while Nathan's doing the Googles, that's it for the review-gles.
Hey, bars.
We're going to move on. And we're gonna talk about the dance sensation that's sweeping the nation. Everyone's doing the What You Watching, Bud.
What you watching, bud? I don't know what you're watching, bud. I'll tell you so. Do, 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 do.
And we're going to find out what we've all been watching. Some good stuff, maybe. So, Brent, I ask you, friend, sir, companion.
Oh.
You're my companion, right?
Yeah, you already know. They heard the last episode.
Oh, shit.
That's why WWE Hall of Famers think you guys are married.
You too. You in there too. It's a trifecta.
What do you mean think? Wait, this isn't real to you guys? It's real to me, damn it. Brent, what you watching, bud?
Honestly, I usually have a lot I can tell you, but because of school, I ain't really been able to watch shit. I got like 70 Blu-rays I'm looking at that I ain't watched none of, but I did watch one thing.
So do you have any lectures you want to recommend? Or?
I mean, if you want to learn about fucking servers and shit like that, I can tell you about some servers. But one thing I did watch that I got a lot of enjoyment out of.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to be so mad when I say it. I was looking at Pluto. And they were showing Mortal Kombat Annihilation.
Motherfucker.
And I highly recommend you watch Mortal Kombat Annihilation. Do not listen to them. Listen to me. Look, Brent.
Take our word for it. That movie is trash.
Look. You heard their pain. Now listen, mine is important. I'm your friend. I wouldn't steer you wrong. You like to have fun. Me and PJ, we like to have fun. So I'm going to send you to the fun movies. Don't watch that movie thing in this fucking for screening country. You watch your thing in this home video hustle where you don't give a fuck. You get drunk, you get high, and you watch flippy shit.
And then when it's over, you go, what were they thinking?
Exactly. Then you go back to Brent and Nathan. But while the movie's playing, you get your hustle on, and you have fun. And then you ask the questions later.
So there you go.
I don't care. 8 out of 10, bruh. Easily.
8 out of 10 people found that review helpful.
They did. And you're welcome, everybody. When's that coming up on the podcast, damn it?
Oh, sometime, I'm sure.
I want to be here.
Okay. All right,
I gotta defend it.
You staked your claim. Nathan, what about you, bud? What you watch, bud?
Well, I just got some new Mystery Science Theater in the mail the other day. It was a collection of the singles. Movies that they released that didn't get into box sets and stuff like that, which I think is kind of poor thinking on their part. They could have actually done like another box set, because now the new box sets are running real short. A lot of them end up like shorts and other stuff that I don't want that. But anyways, I got this singles collection and it had Iga on it, which is absolutely my favorite Mystery Science Theater 3000 episode. It's the first one I ever watched.
Oh shit.
And it is the measuring stick that I held every single episode afterwards up to, and nothing has surpassed it. It is my absolute favorite. Iga, Arch Hall Sr., Arch Hall Jr., and Richard Kiel and Marilyn Manning.
There you go.
Check it out.
And watch out for snakes.
Watch out for snakes. I think it's actually on. It's on Tubi. So if you can't get a hold of the singles collection, so
just watch the Mitchie Science City version. It's on YouTube.
Yeah. And what about you there, Brendan? What are you watching, bud?
I watched a super disturbing horror movie. I'm not surprised. It's German horror movie, and it's called Angst.
I've heard of this.
Okay. Yeah, it's about a guy who gets out of prison, and the whole time we're getting his voiceover. Basically, we're hearing his thoughts as he's like looking for his next victim. He is like, basically that's the whole movie. We're following him as he's staking people out. He finally finds who he wants as his next victim. And the fucked up thing about this and what makes this so disturbing is we hear like how he's rationalizing in his brain why he's doing the things he's doing. Like he'll say things like, you know, I've killed the son, but I can't let the mother die. She has to see her son's dead body so she knows what's coming for her. Of course, I've got to make sure this happens in this order because otherwise, I'm going to have a fit and stuff like that. And it's just like it blew my mind. Like I've never quite seen anything like this. It was very disturbing and not super easy to watch, but as a movie, it was kind of a masterpiece, and it's only like 75 minutes long. Ooh. So I think you can watch it on Tubi. Yep. Brace yourself. Like, fair warning, it's difficult, but if you can, check it out. Angst.
There you go.
Okay.
I looked up the wrong Angst just now, and there's one from 2003. Do you know about this plot? Because this shit right here, this might be something to watch. Fuck it. Helen finds herself having intimacy problems with men. Her private parts are devouring all lovers and leaving her with an insatiable thirst for blood. In order to satisfy her craving, she becomes a prostitute, which leads to a death-filled tale of murder, madness, and sex. Stay tuned to Homeville Hustle. We will be watching this movie at some point.
Sounds almost like Teeth.
Yeah, I was going to say, it does sound like Teeth.
Again, stay tuned to Homeville Hustle. I'm going to make him watch that too one day.
I do kind of remember liking the movie Teeth. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
That's one way I remember about it. But anywho, that's what we're all watching. Nathan, is your old pal Montrose hanging around?
He is. I will bring him in.
Behave yourself, Brent. Behave yourself.
I'm always on my best behavior.
It's better behave than Steve is most of the time.
Yeah, Montrose. Exactly. It's true. See?
It's true. Yeah. Hello! It's good friend Montrose Munkington III here, and I just would like to invite all of you to my YouTube channel, Montrose Munkington TV. You can see some videos of me watching some rather strange wrestling as of late. Not a whole lot of WWE content happening for me these days, and I'm kind of liking it that way. If you have comments on that, we can be friends on Facebook at the Facebook group Montrose Munkington III Esquire and Friends. And finally, if you just want to tweet at me your thoughts of these independent wrestling promotions, you can do that on Twitter at Montrose the Third. That's the number 3RD. Thank you. More later.
Hey, my Montrose, how far you go? I got a question.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Have you seen the movie Nope yet?
Nope.
Oh, I just was curious because there's a scene involving some monkeys in that movie. And I was curious about your thoughts on it because I picture when I see that movie, I won't spoil it for you, but there's a scene in that movie where I just picture that's how you feel around Brendan and Nathan every week. And that's what you want to do to them.
I will have to keep my eye out for it. I do love a good Jordan Peele horror movie. The man knows what he's doing.
That's very true. I just know now if I see that look in your eye, I know what's about to happen and I'm going to leave. I'm not going to tell Brendan. I'm just going to leave. Nathan should know too. He hangs around you now.
I'll see it and we'll actually keep it on the DL as they say.
Yeah, yeah. Just don't do that. Don't do that.
Okay. All right. Well, no promises. No promises. Thank you. More later.
And Brent, thank you for stopping by once again. Thank you for getting your hustle on, getting your thinking cap on. If they want to find you talking movies and other stuff, where can they do that?
They can find me in the back of the theater, clapping them cheeks.
Straight fucking.
That's right.
Wait, that's not going to save you the mad cream.
Probably not. You can find me over on Twitter at capital H, capital V, capital H, capital P, lowercase I-cast, HVH podcast on Twitter with 1D, because right now you only need 1D. Don't worry about 2. Don't be greedy, motherfucker. Just take 1D. It's fine. And you go over to Instagram and Homeville Hustle. I got Brendan almost. I got you. You go over to Instagram, Homeville Hustle podcast. Facebook, Home Video Hustle. YouTube, Home Video Hustle. Because we put out videos every Wednesday. So if you want to see what I look like, you can go look on the fucking video. And if you don't want to, then fuck it. Just listen to the audio. That works too. We got patreon.com/homevideohustle. You can get bonus stuff and help support the show. And I don't know when this is coming out, but recently, Brendan was on the Home Video Hustle once again, and we watched Hard Cock Zombies.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Hard Rock Zombies. Now, let me ask Nathan, because he can answer this question. Now, because Brendan kind of struggled with this question. I'm going to ask Nathan. What is the difference between hard rock and metal?
That's actually a very good question. Hard rock is definitely going to be more of your standard Bon Jovi, loving chicks, wanting chicks, drinking beers, straightforward with heavy guitar, heavy crunchy guitars and drums. Whereas with heavy metal, you're actually going to run into more lyrical content, possibly about dragons, maybe about war. Guitars are considerably crunchier and heavier bass lines.
I agree, though, Brent. The movie should have been called Pop Ballad Zombies.
That's right. Singing-ass zombies.
Not that hard, eh?
Oh, Cassie!
Oh, you got to drop it in for Nathan. You got to drop it in for him. That song legit played a kept count. We played that song 13 times during that episode.
But here's the thing. A hard rock band, so like a Bon Jovi or even a Warrant, would have a song like that.
Yeah.
Oh,
I was because so. Who'd you say? Who'd you throw out there for an example? I think Brendan said, like, was it Led Zeppelin? You said it's hard rock.
I think I said Zeppelin, and then like obviously like something like Metallica would be heavy metal.
Yeah, like I thought Guar. Like Guar is metal, right?
Guar is metal, but they're like a weird theatrical gore metal. And I know it's stupid just to throw these kind of almost arbitrary labels onto it, because Metallica is metal, but people would say they're thrash metal. There are people that will argue that Led Zeppelin is metal. They are wrong, but I mean they'll argue it. Oh my god,
there's one. You gotta sing it too, Brendan. 48 seconds, Brendan. You ain't letting that, you gotta give him the first line, though. Go listen to Hard Rock Zombie episode. That's not hard rock, right, Nathan?
No, that's definitely not. No.
That's why I was asking these questions.
Like, Richard Marx would go, that's edgy, but that's really about as much as you're going to get with that.
Is that Karl Marx's son?
No,
it's the founder of socialism.
There you go. Brenda didn't play the first line of the song either.
Oh, the line about her being underage?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the very first thing he talks about, Nathan.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's I'm like, so in love, but you're so young.
Yeah. Right away, you're like, oh, God.
Ooh, pedal rock. Yeah.
It's kind of on par for that kind of music back in the 80s. I've heard.
I mean, there's a couple of songs by some big bands that would have, if you listen to the lyrics, it would have you raising a few eyebrows. That's all I'm saying. Yeah. But thank you. Yes, once again, thank you, Brent, for being here. As we wrap up, though, me, of course, being the Tekken expert on this podcast, on this episode,
yeah,
right. Nathan, sure. Do you have any questions about this movie?
Well, I guess in a movie based on a fighting game.
Right.
Where they actually have fighting.
What?
In a tournament style, in a fighting game, I mean, a movie that's based on a fighting game with a tournament.
Hmm.
And in the movie where they actually pay some decent amount of fan service to costume design, signature moves, but kind of ignore the actual story of the characters that is also deep rich in the instruction manuals of the Tekken games.
Mm-hmm.
I simply gotta ask, what was Mortal Kombat Annihilation thinking?
That it was fucking wonderful.
Garbage!
Fun. Learn to have fun, Nathan.
Awful.
Learn to have fun out here. The world is too stressful to not have fun.
I am tons of fun. In fact, people call me that all the time.
Hey.
backyard, pull up in your fast car, whistling my name. Open up a beer and you say get over here and play a video game. I'm in his favorite sundress, watching me get undressed, take that body downtown. I say you the bestest, leaning for a big kiss, put his favorite perfume on, go play your video game. It's you, it's you, it's all for you, everything I do, I tell you all the time. Heaven is a place on earth with you, tell me all the things.